voice brought the message to the children of the sun. For the return of the buffalo and for a better day to come.
You can kill my body, you can damn my soul. I'm not believing in your God and some world down below.
But you don't stand a chance against my prayers. You don't stand a chance against my love. The old law and the ghost dance. We shall live again. We shall live again.
Not a racist. I do not hate white people. But by the same token, I cannot make excuses. Cannot cover up what has happened so that white America will be on our side. There's a stereotype that the so-called minority people have of the whites. It's a stereotype we did not create. We did not create the corruption. We did not create the hypocrisy. We did not create the philosophy of death for materialism. We've had to survive with all this surrounding us. You know, at one point in the dealings, in the historical dealings of the Indian people and the white people, there was no hatred. But this ruling class, this privileged few, they wanted our land, your George Washingtons and your Benjamin Franklins and your Patrick Henrys. They wanted our land. So they created race hatred because they saw that our societies were structured so that all the people were taken care of. And their philosophy was the European philosophy, take what you can get for yourself. They passed laws against marriage between Indian and white. They created derogatory terms, squaw man, Indian lover. And the basic motivation behind this was to get our land. The first whites came over here, they said, look, the Indians are like children. They're harmless. And then as the settlers started coming over, the immigrants, they liked our people because the immigrants did not know how to survive on this land base. They needed our people to show them how. Then once the immigrants developed the knowledge of survival on this land base, the hostile attitudes developed. Savages, pagans, heathens. Indians aren't human. So they started creating conditions to go to war against us, to use their military might, and then they had their westward expansion. We went from being savages and pagans to being red niggers and hostiles. The only good Indian's a dead Indian. And all the time they were taking more of our land. The American system used a language of genocide. And our people fought back. Then they used their lies and their trickery to sign the treaties. Treaties they had no intention of honoring. After they had taken most of our land, to perpetuate the American hypocrisy of humanity, they said, we'll assimilate these Indians Indians can be as good as white people. They changed the language out front from genocide to assimilation. But there was one difference. That's all that was changed. With genocidal rhetoric, they used the 7th Cavalry. They used diseased blankets. They used the murder of women and children. With assimilation tactics, they used alcohol. They used the Christian church. They used extreme poverty. They used a double standard of law. And the result under both policies was one of extermination of the red people. But while we sat back and accepted this for the last 60 years, we were all right. We were good Indians. There weren't any militant Indians then. Indians get mad and fight each other, commit terrible crimes against each other. And we weren't militant. Then all of a sudden we start to open our eyes. And we start to think to ourselves, we're fools to destroy ourselves. We're fools to sit back and allow this to happen. So we start standing up for our rights. We start saying what we believe. And they call us communist. They call us subversive. They call us radical. The whole history of the white man's civilization, they have always called us names. And the irony of all of it was before there was ever a white man on this land, every tribal group, every Indian nation on this land, their tribal names always meant the people. We always called ourselves the people. We've never heard the white man call us that. And all of a sudden, when we start thinking of ourselves as the people again, there's something that grows inside and it says we're going to be treated like the people. You see, because we're not looking for civil rights. I don't want any civil rights. Dennis Banks doesn't want any civil rights. Russell Means doesn't want them. Gladys Bissonette doesn't want them. We want our human rights. And there's a real big difference. Human rights we all get by the very act of birth. The very act of our creation means we are entitled to human rights. The rights to respect, dignity, control of our own lives. Civil rights are only something that a political system legislates for you after they deny you your human rights. Civil rights were created for the white people. They were not created for the Indians or the blacks or the Chicanos or the Asians. Because we have always known that we are human beings and we have the right to do as we please. We have the right to eat where we want, be educated how we want. It was the white people didn't know that. So they passed civil rights legislation, put it on paper so that white racist redneck restaurant owner could read it and see, hey, I have to let them. Civil rights are the biggest insult to democracy that there is. If you have a damn democracy, then why do you need civil rights? If you have freedom, why do you have to have an overstuffed bureaucracy to fuck you over every day of your life? Why do you let parasites feed off of you while they control you? Because that's 90% of what your bureaucrats do. They feed off the people. We want a value change. This is the difference between the Indian people and the United States government. This has always been the difference. We reject the values. We do not believe in the white Anglo-Saxon European value system. We question the mental stability of a society that will go out and spend $2 million rearranging rock to build a church when the most sacred temples are already in existence. We do not understand a philosophy that says God is white and God is in heaven, and if you don't believe in God under one of their organized, defined religions, then you have no religion. That is insanity. We do not understand how an entire race of people, 200 million people, can live in this country and say that they have humanitarian concerns and yet sit back and allow the federal government to violate every person on this land's human rights. You see, so when something happens in Oglala, South Dakota, it's only a matter of self-defense. The war started the day the first Indian person was killed by a European. That's when the war started. The war has not stopped. It is still here. When we have a 45-year life expectancy, we're dying. And death is an end result of war. When we have a larger percentage of our people locked up in prisons than we have with jobs, the one thing in the movement that we are coming to recognize is that we play one small part in the total history of our people. We do not look upon ourselves as being defeated people. We fight for the same things that our ancestors fought for. We educate our young to fight for the same things we're fighting for. Our people lived on this land base for hundreds of thousands of years. This oppression that surrounds us and seeks to destroy us right now has been here for less than 500. We know it's going to take some time, but we also know we're not going to let the name calling and the intimidation just drive us away.
At noon today, after the first 24 hours of a vigil being conducted in front of the White House by members of the American religious community, a second letter was hand-delivered to the White House in behalf of the Lakota peoples and their delegation in Washington, D.C. The group will continue its vigil 24 hours a day to bear witness to the struggles of the Oglala Lakota and to seek a genuine response from Ford, who has ignored the delegation for the past 2 months. The Lakota delegation in Washington, D.C. has been seeking President Ford's personal involvement as Chief of State in reviewing the 1868 Fort Laramie Treaty and in ending the conditions which have caused violence and bloodshed on the Pine Ridge Reservation in South Dakota. The Lakota delegation describes the meeting as an extreme necessity because the situation on Pine Ridge worsens day by day and because only by executive action can there be any immediate and positive change. During these past 2 months, the delegation has met with dozens of senators and congresspeople. They have secured the support of the South Dakota congressional delegation, the Black Caucus, and many different religious organizations and civil rights groups. There has been no formal response from the White House. Lakota delegation has set November 10th as a deadline for an answer from Ford. According to Larry Redshirt, coordinator for the delegation, quote, "The situation on and off the reservation is today and will be tomorrow that of an extremely explosive situation that could blow up again with yet another bloodbath. We know that the U.S. government is involved in an attempt to systematically destroy all forms of resistance like the struggle of our people because of the coming bicentennial celebration. We also know that we have the only untapped natural resources in the country, and that today, the national energy crisis, inflation, and recession, the eyes of the monstrous corporate state, backed by their military, take hold once again of our homeland." One of the priorities of Lakota's mission in Washington is to seek amnesty for all those involved in Wounded Knee, Custer, Sioux Falls, and related cases. Today, the last Wounded Knee trial is being conducted in Council Bluffs, Iowa. James Robidoux is on trial in Custer, and Russell Means continues with his trial in Sioux Falls. last Wounded Knee trial began in Council Bluffs on Monday. The case, called the Big Three, involves charges of assaulting federal officers and intending to kill Curtis Fitzgerald and Larry McGee, two federal officers wounded during the Wounded Knee occupation. At this point in the trial, one defendant, Colin Kingfisher, has had all of the charges against him dropped. A second defendant, Frank Blackhorse, has apparently gone underground. And only the third defendant, Bernardo Escamilla, will stand trial on the charges. He has pled not guilty, and jury selection continues through its second day. In Custer, the trial of James Gregory Robidoux began yesterday with Judge Tice dismissing two of the three charges against Robidoux, those of third-degree burglary and assault with a deadly weapon. Since the incident had occurred over 32 months ago, Robidoux feels that the state has violated his right to a speedy trial, but Judge Tice has not yet ruled on this aspect of the case. The jury selection continues today. So far, six prospective jurors have been dismissed for cause. Robidoux's only remaining charge, that of riot where arson was committed, stems from an incident in February of 73 in Custer, South Dakota. On that day, Sarah Badhart Bull had come to town with some supporters to protest the state's unresponsive attitude towards the murder of her son, Wesley. When she was attacked and strangled by the police, people burned down the Custer Courthouse and the Chamber of Commerce building. In Sioux Falls, the trial of Muscle Means continues through its second day. During one of the earlier Custer trials, that of Dave Hill, the presiding judge, Bottom, had jailed an Indian defense lawyer, Ramon Rubidoux, and then on the following day, the judge ordered the county tactical squad to carry the 16 Indian spectators out of the courtroom because, as the judge testified yesterday, the Indians had remained seated during the proceedings and were not demonstrating enough respect for the cart. When Dave Hill, the defendant, was carried bleeding and unconscious from the courthouse, a window-breaking protest occurred outside the courthouse. Charges for the incidents outside were dropped last spring. Prosecutor Muhlenberg said that the state would prove that Russell Means and not Judge Bottom had pre-planned the riot and had come to the courthouse specifically to interrupt the hearings and trash the courthouse.
John, as an Indian living here in the city, we don't often get all the information that's coming from the reservation or the information that passes on reservations. So how do you feel that the support is around the nation in cities and reservations?
They had that trouble in Pine Ridge, all right, with the agents getting shot. Everyone has accused AIM of doing it. They haven't produced any facts yet, but AIM has been accused. But I think the important thing on that whole thing, AIM is accused of murdering FBI agents in the Oglala community. Yet, the people that have been accused of doing the murdering have not been apprehended. So now we have to look at this. Now, does the Oglala community support or not support? Do we have credibility or not have credibility? The government can't catch us because half of the case that they build against us most of the time is they fabricate it out of thin air. See, and it's been very hard for them to catch us on a lot of things. So in particular with the Pine Ridge situation, what the government's doing is they're going after the supporters, the people we have credibility with. That's who's being terrorized now. It's a very common terroristic tactic by a police state.
All right, I think you brought up a good point. Where John Eagle, who has been accused of the murder of the FBI agents, turned himself in willingly on supposedly on an alleged burglar charge, and yet he is subsequently being indicted for the murder of those FBI agents. And there is no proof on that yet.
See, the reason that Jimmy Eagle has been indicted and charged is allegedly he was one of the individuals the two agents were looking for. Federal government, through manipulation of the media, sold the story to America that AIM had executed and ambushed. They sold the story to America that there were 16 hostiles in that house that did it. And they couldn't produce not even one. So this is where Jimmy Eagle's got faced with this rap. They needed someone visible to show we have a prisoner. Jimmy Eagle happened to be the man that they picked for that role. The case is not built on evidence or anything else. It's a matter they needed someone, and they've got someone.
Machita muy ambigui, machita muy conspiru.